from wherever you're watching us in Kenya and around the world. You're in time for KBC Prime Edition, coming to you from Broadcasting House in Nairobi, Kenya. And it's good to have you. Thank you so much for making KBC Channel 1 your channel of choice. Good evening. My name is Tom Boyer. Let's begin this live coverage with a look at our top stories. Follow the cash trail. The controller of budget drops a bombshell.
Where there is a number one, Ministry of Petroleum and Mining, 16.597 billion, and I went ahead and approved.
The burden of banditry. Cattle rustlers strike again as leaders demand a change in strategy. Plus, Matiang'i honors summons, but the former interior boss faces charges of conspiracy to commit a felony. Our sign language tonight is Susan Thuku. Our socials at KBC Channel 1. My Twitter handle at TomBoyer24. We open with our top story. Now, the controller of budget, Margaret Nyakango, now claims she was threatened by former Treasury Cabinet Secretary Ukuru Yatani to approve the withdrawal of monies amounting to 15 billion shillings just a few days before the general elections. Nyakango Tuesday told the National Assembly's Public Petitions Committee that she had no choice but to append her signature as directed, because Ambassador Yatani would from time to time invoke the name of the then President Uhuru Kenyatta. Gladys Mwingai opens our coverage with that report.
The Controller of Budget, Margaret Nyakango, says she was coerced to approve withdrawals of 15.5 billion shillings just days before the general elections. While appearing before the National Assembly Public Petitions Committee, the Controller of Budget revealed that former Treasury Cabinet Secretary Ukur Yatani on various occasions invoked the name of former President Uhuru Kenyatta in demanding that she act as requested.
Chair, there are expenditures after 8th August, where there is a number one, Ministry of Petroleum and Mining, 16.597 billion, and I went ahead and approved. And I know that now the Auditor General will pick up and find out what the actual expenditure was.
According to the control of budget, the former Treasury boss sought the approval of 6 billion shillings to enable the government buy shares from Helios Investment and Exit Telecoms Kenya, and 9.2 billion shillings from the annuity fund to buy three key infrastructure projects.
Even as I sit here, I'm still not convinced.
What's the total amount of money that was approved? That you approved?
This is coming to 15.5 for the two. What we see here really cannot be justified. This is what it borders on abuse.
Committee Chair Nimrod Mvai says they're investigating suspected withdrawal of 50 billion shillings that was done a few days before and after the general elections. The committee has also summoned Treasury Cabinet Secretary Njuguna Ndungu for a second time after he failed to appear before the committee investigating a petition filed by the Consumer Federation of Kenya Secretary General Stephen Mutoro.
They have failed to appear. All the other stakeholders have appeared, including State House. So we are left with no option. But before issuing the warrant of arrest, we are supposed to do a reminder, which has been sent today.
Deputy President Rigathi Gachagua has on two occasions announced that he'll name those behind the alleged lootings of public coffers, monies he said ran into billions of shillings.
Pale katika police air wing, pale Wilson, ndio pesa ilikuwa inaletwa na maguria, inawekwa kwa ndege, inapelekwa kwa mtu nyumbani, inapelekwa kwa mwingine. In the next few days, nitatangazia wa Kenya, pesa ilienda kwa nani, kwa nani, kwa nani, kwa nani. Wasi tuletee sisi.
For Prime Edition, I'm Gladys Munga.
Now, Turkana Governor Jeremiah Lomorukai now wants the government to withdraw the Kenya Defence Forces from the ongoing multi-agency operation against bandits. Governor Lomorukai claims that KDF is complicit in an alleged bombing that killed 19 innocent lives in Turkana County.
Amidst the ongoing multi-agency operation being mounted by the Kenya Defence Forces, the Rapid Deployment Unit and the Anti-Stock Theft Unit, a section of leaders now want the government to relook into the deployment. Turkana Governor Jeremiah Lomorukai wants the government to withdraw the Kenya Defence Forces, accusing them of targeting innocent civilians in the flash-out operation.
Apart from the RDU and the ASTU, the Kenya Defence Forces instead are now running against the innocent people of Turkana County. That is my word.
Governor Lomorukai claims officers from KDF bombed innocent civilians a few days ago and killed 19 people. The governor further wants Interior Cabinet Secretary Kithure Kindiki to order for the summons and investigations of a section of leaders from neighboring counties that he accuses of inciting violence.
They are now ferrying people across through Kainuk with motorbikes and vehicles, beeping security there to come and kill the innocent people of Turkana.
This comes amidst another reported fresh attack in Elgeyo Marakwet that left two people dead. A medical practitioner was shot dead in a rural area of Marakwet West and an unknown number of livestock stolen in the area. A mother was also shot by bandits at Kowo near Chesogon of Marakwet East.
I've been threatened by so many of them, telling me there is nothing that the government can do to us because we are very powerful and we have powerful guns. I want you, Professor, to bomb that area. I want you to bomb these culprits so that they know the government exists.
On Sunday, bandits staged a retaliatory attack in Baringo South, injuring a police reservist while making away with over 200 head of livestock. In the meantime, the government is engaging neighboring counties in a bid to rein in on cross-border smuggling of illegal firearms, fueling conflict and crimes in the north. Interior Principal Secretary Raymond Omolo says the government is keen on ending the violence and conflict in the north by cutting the supply of firearms. John Jacob Curia, Prime Edition.
Former Interior Cabinet Secretary Dr. Fred Matiang'i may face charges of conspiracy to commit a felony by trying to cause public panic over the purported raid at his current home on the 8th of February 2023. Matiang'i, who was accompanied by a battery of lawyers and Azimio leader Raila Odinga, was Tuesday questioned by detectives at the Directorate of Criminal Investigations for close to 9 hours. They may also be charged for publication of false information, and that's according to a charge sheet drafted by the police. Timothy Kipnusu will be bringing us that story a little later on. I understand it's not ready. But let's look at another story now. Azimio One Kenya Coalition Party has given Senate Speaker Amason Kingi 2 days ultimatum to effect the leadership changes of the minority party. Azimio Party leader Raila Odinga held consultations with his senators at the parliament building and resolved to give a way forward on how to deal with Speaker Kingi. Here's that report.
Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Coalition Party leader Raila Odinga paid a courtesy call to Senate Minority Leader Stewart Matsayo to engage on how to compel Senate Speaker to effect leadership changes in the Senate. Raila left the premises, giving Speaker Amason Kingi 2 days to recognize the leadership changes made by Azimio.
It appears if the Speaker of the Senate is not allowing the Senate to function the way we know it, the leadership of political parties should never be interfered with by the Speaker of the Senate. When a political party chooses to change leadership or to whip a member for any reason, it is none of the business of the Speaker to interfere.
The minority party wants to replace Isiolo Senator Fatuma Dulo with Narok Senator Ledama Olekina as the minority whip, and also install Nairobi Senator Edwin Sifuna as the deputy minority whip. The Senate Speaker is, however, yet to communicate the changes. Therefore, status quo remains.
This has not been effected up to today, because I hear the Speaker is stubborn and is listening, or says he's respecting a ruling by a tribunal. Speaker Kaparo made a ruling very clearly that Parliament cannot be injuncted in performing his duties. So I want to urge the Speaker to allow Azimio to effect the changes in leadership in the House.
And with the selection panel of the recruitment of IEBC having advertised for positions of commissioners, Raila avoided the question as to whether he will continue the demonstrations against the constitution of IEBC.
I want you to wait for the time. The deadline is tomorrow, midnight. So you will hear from us on Thursday.
Raila Odinga had given the government a fortnight to lower the cost of living and facilitate scrutiny of IBC servers. Geshoke Washira, Prime Edition.
Well, earlier on, the Azimio leader Raila Odinga and a battery of lawyers accompanied the former cabinet secretary for interior, Dr. Fred Matiang'i, for questioning by detectives at the Directorate of Criminal Investigations. That process taking around about 9 hours. We understand that Matiang'i may be facing charges of conspiracy to commit felony by trying to cause public panic over the purported raid at his current home. He may also be charged for publishing false information, and that's according to a charge sheet that we had a look at and that was drafted by the police. Timothy Kipnusu's report is now ready. Let's listen in.
At 8:30 a.m. Tuesday morning at the DCI headquarters, Kiambu Road, the convoy of former Interior Cabinet Secretary Dr. Fred Matiang'i arrived with his supporters. There was a bit of scuffle outside the DCI headquarters after police officers manning the entrance adamantly refused to let in the car that was carrying the former CS, requiring him to alight and walk.
When you'll be arrested, I'll defend you the way I was defended.
The Azimio la Umoja leader Raila Odinga, who arrived at the DCI headquarters at around 3 p.m., was not allowed in either.
What kind of control sessions? Look here, this is a public office. And I have a right to go inside.
The former premier accusing the government of pushing a political narrative by trying to humiliate the former powerful cabinet secretary.
Kenyans will not accept this kind of rule. We will not allow this country to recede back to the past days. It will be resisted. It will not be acceptable. I want to say very clearly, this is not acceptable at all.
The leaders accompanied the former CS, led by Kisii Senator Richard Onyunka and former Defense Cabinet Secretary Eugene Wamalwa, calling on the police to act professionally in undertaking the probe.
Viongozi wa serikali ya Kenya Kwanza walikuwa nasema hawataki uongozi wa kimabavu, uongozi mbaya, uongozi ambao ni wa kusukuma wananchi kwa sababu ya siasa.
Minister for Interior, who has worked with distinction for this great country as a minister for ICT, minister for education and interior, and even lands office, to be treated in the manner he has been treated, for his home to have been raided, his children's bedroom was broken into. We are saying a travesty of justice, and this should not happen to any other Kenyan.
His team of lawyers, who included Danson Omari, Okongo Omogeni and Otiende Omolo, claiming the summons were in bad faith, wondering why the former CS was interrogated on matters not related to the summons.
They were not asking questions about Section 23 or about the, what was contained in the summons. They were asking Dr. Matiang'i everything about his life, where he lives, what property he has, what farming he has, and other things. So when we realized that they were on a fishing expedition, our client invoked his right under Article 49.
After that, the officer said then they will have to consult and make a decision. They have been consulting for the last 6 hours.
I want to state as a senior counsel and as someone who has lived in this country for many years that since the times of James Gichuru, the first interior CS, I've never seen a CS who leaves office and then is summoned by junior officers 4 months after transition.
After spending 9 hours in the hands of detectives from the Directorate of Criminal Investigation here in Kembu, the former Interior Cabinet Secretary, Dr. Fred Matiang'i, is a free man. This even as a section of leaders who accompanied him faulted the government for what they term as political persecution. Timothy Kipnosu for Prime Edition, Nairobi.
Of course, we have our pulse on that story. Let's go into the corridors of justice now. The High Court has upheld the election of Homa Bay County Governor Gladys Wanga in throwing out a petition filed by former Nairobi County Governor Evans Odhiambo Kidero. The court said that Wanga was legally elected, directing Kidero to pay the cost of litigation. The High Court has, in the meantime, upheld the election of Starehe Member of Parliament Amos Mwago. Justice Martin Muya said that the elections were conducted substantially in accordance with the principles that are laid down in the Constitution.
In accordance with the principles laid down in the Constitution and written law, the non-compliance did not affect the results. I find that the election petition, this election petition, has no merit and is dismissed with costs to the respondents. It is instructive to note that this election petition was filed by voters. It has its fair share of in the lottery applications, mostly at the behest of the petitioner.
Well, that story brings us to a fast break right here on Prime Edition. We're taking a short break, but we're coming back. Don't go away. Stay with us.
Kuna hizi kampuni zenye zinajua mali niko, kitu nimekula breko, kitu nasema sahi, kitu nitakula next week on Thursday, pesa niko nazo kwa account siblings wangu, the list is endless. Na mnajuaje hii information? Kwani mnani stock? Eh?
Lakini nikuulize, kabla ya kupress allow, ulijiuliza hii information ilitumiwa kwa njia gani? Kabla ya kuallow, hakikisho umesoma terms and conditions.
Ujumbe huu umeletwa kwako na ofisi ya Data Protection Commissioner.
Nimesahau kucheza Loto Moto.
Usisahau kucheza Loto Moto. Shinda milioni mbili kila siku kwenye M-Pesa. Chagua lipa na M-Pesa. Paybill number 757070. Account number andika neno Loto. Kisha weka star na nambari yako ya simu. Weka kiwango chochote cha pesa kuanzia shilingi 50 hadi 2000.
Au lali.
Lipa kisha subiri draw.
Wela la. Nda kutimizia ndoto zako. Milioni mbili usiamini.
Ujumbe huu umeidhinishwa na BCLB.
After the dust settled on rigorous campaigns, Kenyans are waiting for elected leaders to deliver on their pledges.
To have clean, accessible drinking water across the country.
The hustle of everyday Kenyans is encouraged
and rewarded.
Operationalizing Kerugoya Level 5 Hospital.
A functioning school feeding program.
But how have the leaders performed so far?
The percentage of A's in 2021 were more than those ones in 2022.
We will not politicize security, because if we do so, we endanger the country.
Every week, we bring you an honest assessment of the national and county governments.
One of the best ways of accelerating national development is through collaboration with county governments.
The Scorecard, coming soon on KBC Channel 1.
Welcome back to Prime Edition, our socials at KBC Channel 1, my Twitter handle at Mboya 24. The spouse of the Deputy President, Dorcas Rigathi, has said gender equality can only be achieved by the inclusion of the male gender and attain more through the involvement of both men and boys. Speaking at the United Nations headquarters in New York during the commissioning of the Status of Women, Pastor Dorcas highlighted the critical role the male gender plays in preventing gender-based violence against women and girls in Africa, where families are highly patriarchal. She rallied UN member countries to build positive masculinity among men and boys from across the world and aid in ending gender-based violence. Now, back home, parents of students at the Upper Hill Boys High School in Nairobi, Kenya, Tuesday stormed the school following cases of diarrhea among learners. The anxious parents sought to know the status of their children, as others were allowed to leave with their children for medical checkup. The Nairobi County Director for Preventive and Promotive Health, Carol Ngunu, who visited the school, says majority of students who had diarrhea and vomiting tested positive for amoebiosis. Kamchemeza tells us more.
This was the situation at Upper Hill Boys High School, Nairobi, on Tuesday. Parents trickling in, seeking to see their children after cases of diarrhea and vomiting were reported at the school.
We have communicated with the parents of the sick children. So as of now, I want you to see your children. If they tell you they are sick and need to go home, we will allow you to do so.
But I talked to my son and he told me that he has some headaches, some stomach aches. So I said, if we can basically take our children to hospital, I mean, where is the problem?
Yeah, I've got a message stating that there's a cholera outbreak. So I came to visit a brother of mine here, who is a former student. Mm-hmm. I came to check his situation, whether he's well or unwell.
While some managed to live with their children to conduct medical checkup at their preferred health facilities, some remained stranded at the gate.
Ni head teacher manani, but a certain lady akisema kuna nini jambo kama hilo, lakini akutaka kwa alert wazazi. Si kuoga haraka na kukuja. Kukuja hapa watu mananiambia kuna kitu kayo, ni maneno ya watu wa media. Sasa ninangoja. I would like to know what is happening, what is going on. Na sijui nani ataniambia. Napigia mwalimu simu ni kama haingi. Ninangoja hata mimi amin darkness.
So far we are just requesting for the permission of the nene, for the administration to allow us to see our children.
No, actually they were denying us to get to the gate, but I've managed to get her, whatever. I have to be assured that my son is okay.
Nairobi County Director of Preventive and Promotive Health, Carol Ngunu, who together with a section of education and health officials visited the school on Tuesday, said about 100 students complained of vomiting and diarrhea.
Our initial tests and what we have treated for has been amoebiasis. And so we are investigating what could have been the original cause or source of that infection.
As I came, there were a few parents at the gate. But now it seems the number is growing, and I know you need reassurance, and we also need to know the way forward.
60 of the students were taken to Mbagathi Hospital, while the rest were examined at various health facilities.
Currently admitted, we have the 11 students who we are hoping, after speaking to the doctors, are possibly going to be discharged by end of today. We have taken samples of water food samples from the school. I think it's important as parents for you to get correct information, but as of now we'd like to assure you there is no cause for alarm.
Those who were discharged are undergoing observation at the school and under medication. In the meantime, parents want to be given easy access to check on their children, terming the situation worrisome. Kamche Menza for Prime Edition.
Rally driver Maxine Wahome will be charged with the murder of her late husband, boyfriend Asad Khan. Maxine had been arrested and detained at the Kilimani police station on the 12th of December 2022 and was out on a cash bail of 100,000 shillings. The matter will be mentioned before the High Court for directions. Sarafina Robi with more from the Corridors of Justice.
The Director of Public Prosecution requested to have Maxine Wahome at Kilimani Police Station to undergo a mental assessment before taking plea. Maxine will be charged with murder following the death of a fellow rally driver, Asad Khan. Maxine was arrested on the 12th of December 2022 but has been out on bail. The matter before High Court will be mentioned virtually for directions.
The investigations are now complete and therefore calls for the closure of this file. However, considering the application that has been made, that the respondent is required to appear before the judge this morning, I will mention this matter virtually on Monday so as grant the respondent the opportunity to be to appear before the High Court judge.
Meanwhile, Kenya Water Workers Association General Secretary Elijah Watch has been charged with forgery. It's alleged that on the 12th of February 2021, with the intent to defraud, a Watch allegedly forged a signature on National Executive Committee minutes, purporting it to have been signed by Ahmed Bashir Mohammed. He pleaded not guilty and was released on a cash bail of 200,000 Kenyan shillings. Serafina Robi for Prime Edition.
Now, the ongoing drought has aggravated the myriad of challenges for residents of northern Kenya, literally cutting them off the rest of the country. For them, access to basics such as water, shopping centers, and also health facilities is such toil that they feel denied of a fair chance at life. Here's that report.
To access hospitals, schools, shopping centers, and other such facilities, I would simply walk or take an easy ride to them. But this is not a story about my ease to access such facilities. It is rather a story that is highlighting the sharp contrast witnessed in different parts of the country.
Communities in the northern part of Kenya have borne the brunt of the ravaging drought, leaving them struggling to survive. Scarce resources are further dimming the hopes of life for the most vulnerable. The inadequate infrastructure tends to cut off these communities from the rest of the country. As such, hardly do they travel out, nor do aid agencies access the region. Drought that has decimated livestock, their primary livelihood, and dried rivers threatens the existence of the nomadic and semi-nomadic populations. Desperation has driven some of them to eat wild fruits or carcasses of livestock to survive.
Chakula. Wanawake tu tunaumuka kabisa wanawake kwa sababu wana mtoto anaamuke uji hata pale unapita unaenda kabisa kama ni bahari nana nakaa huko napatiwa samaki moja hii samaki moja hakuna mtu atakula hii samaki hii napatia kidogo dogo kila mtu aonje.
Education has not been spared either, with high dropout rates leaving schools virtually empty owing to the unending search for pasture and water. These adversities have escalated poverty in the region to unbearable levels.
Hasa ile siku mtu aona hiyo shilingi 50 ya kulipa hiyo boat ndio mtoto yako apate kwenda shule. Mtoto yako atakuwa anaenda wapi shule? Atakuwa anakaa hapa kwa nyumbani. So unapata karibu kwa mwezi mtoto anaenda shule 3 weeks.
And should disease strike, access to the nearest health facility is a day-long trek.
These villagers are a day's walk to a healthy clinic. They are 2 days away from a shopping center.
World Vision Disaster Management Director Gershon Mwakazi says interventions need to be urgently scaled up if households are to be cushioned from this humanitarian crisis.
We have seen women and children eating wild food, something that has not been seen for years. And we need to urgently intervene and provide food for this community, cash for this community, multi-purpose cash for this community.
Until then, the residents hang on to the thin hope of the heavens to let down the rains. Thin because forecasts already indicate depressed rainfall. Despite these odds, the locals still exude resilience like that of daffodils, hoping to bloom soon after summer. For Climate Centric, I am Teresa Mutai.
Well, Climate Centric is a new series. It will be coming to you every week on Tuesday. We hope that next Tuesday we'll be looking at the elephant, the largest existing land animal. Very smart as well. How is it surviving under those harsh conditions? So make sure you join us next Tuesday, same time, right here on Prime Edition. Now, unknown to many, and this is since independence, all the way to the year 1999, the Kenya Defense Forces discouraged female soldiers from getting married, believe it or not, or even giving birth due to the inconvenience, of course, of juggling between family and military duties. Lieutenant Colonel Martha Waivaka served as the women corps commander until reforms were initiated that saw the easing of such restrictions. On the eve of the International Women's Day 2023 celebrations, we look at the immense contribution and sacrifice of women in defense forces. Here's Martha Waifaka's story with Missy Nisi Imano on Military Tales.
Lieutenant Colonel Martha Njeri Waithaka joined the military in the late 1970s. Thanks to her nursing profession.
Because I like nursing right from the time I was a young girl. One day my uncle brought me a letter, and when I opened that letter, I saw that I'd been called for an interview at Kenyatta School of Nursing. I went for that interview and I was successful. So in 1971, I joined nursing.
The interest came when she was working at Mathare Mental Hospital in 1977.
While at Mathare, I worked with some two nurses from the military. And they are the ones actually who told me, "Mom, why can't you come and join the military?" I said, "No, because we were supposed to be the pioneers as nursing officers." Then eventually I said, "Now, let me give it a try."
Martha worked for a decade, rising up the ranks to becoming the highest ranking woman commander then.
When the promotion came, I remember I was just inside here in my house, and when the result came of the number one board, one of the officers called me and he told me, "Ma'am, congratulations." I asked him, "For what?" "You've been promoted and appointed CEO Women's Service Corps."
In October of 1971, the Kenya Army recruited women for the first time.
Now, Women's Service Corps was set up as a unit of the Army, because as at that time, it's only the Kenya Army that recruited women.
But agitation continued for women to be recruited to join other units of the military.
The military actually is a kind of, they are seen like, a fighting kind of component. And therefore, they looked at it and saw now women may not be able to take up the roles that men would take, you know, if there is anything, combat and all this.
Were the military duties so uniquely masculine?
Some roles actually came up for the girls, you know, like clerical, being, you know, stores, drivers, signalers, communicators. And this is where now the women now started having, you know, specific roles that they could play.
How different was the training for the Women's Service Corps?
Now, the training actually were basically the same. Yeah, it's only that, you know, upon recruitment, we used to have the women trained within the Women's Service Corps.
The Kenya Air Force was tasked with housing the Women's Corps.
It's where they can have a camp, a women camp within a base. For security reasons, being women, at least, you know, they needed a lot of care and all this. And that's how the Women's Service Corps started.
But the wars of women in the military were far from over, as terms and conditions of service were still not conducive.
Did not allow them to become pregnant or even to get married. But in the event that one wanted at least to go and get married or start a family, they would be discharged from the service.
Again, there was a public uproar in the fight for equality in the military.
Police had already been around at least to get married and even to have children. And I remember with the police, you know, in the event that a girl, perhaps a police woman, you know, fails to get married, at least they were allowed to have one child. So the question was now, why them, why not these ones, you know?
Military as an employer was expected to employ all, regardless of gender.
The women, you know, Maendeleo, Wanawake in agitation, they started actually, you know, trying at least to see whether those terms could be changed. But it took a long time for them to be changed. And therefore, any girl who would become pregnant, they just, upon being discovered, she would just be ready to go home.
Eventually, in November of 1999, President Moi allowed for equal rights to be granted to men and women.
It was a very joyous moment, more so for the women, me inclusive. The world was open for the girls, because today there's a lot of progression, because when I was there, I was the highest, the senior most, but today we have Major General.
This was the climax of the Women's Service Corps.
They all went to celebrate in whatever ways, you know, they knew how.
Colonel Martha Waithaka was the last commanding officer of the Women's Service Corps until 1999.
Of course, tomorrow the world celebrates the International Women's Day for the year 2023. I can see Wairimu Njenga on the other side of the studio, ready to bring you the day's business. Stay with us.
Dust settled on rigorous campaigns. Kenyans are waiting for elected leaders to deliver on their pledges.
To have clean, accessible drinking water across the country.
The hustle of everyday Kenyans is encouraged and rewarded.
Operationalizing Kerugoya Level 5 Hospital.
A functioning school feeding program.
But how have the leaders performed so far?
The percentage of A's in 2021 were more than those ones in 2022.
We will not politicize security, because if we do so, we endanger the country.
Every week, we bring you an honest assessment of the national and county governments.
One of the best ways of accelerating national development is through collaboration with county governments.
The Scorecard, coming soon on KBC Channel 1.
How dare you stare at this picture every day? Aren't you scared Harvey might see it?
And I'm the one that really likes.
He will not forgive you.
He has to.
Be brave once again. And go tell him the truth.
You again? What in the world did you do? What is wrong with you? Why come here? Just to cause trouble and make a big mess? Let me see you again. Never come back to a mortal.
Where's Jenny?
We'll no longer be in the magazine now.
Well, thank you for joining us as we bring you up to date with the latest in the world of business. My name is Wairu Mujenga. The Kenya Revenue Authority hopes to net an additional 400 billion shillings in tax revenue by snooping the supply chains of businesses. Kenya Revenue Authority Deputy Commissioner in charge of medium taxpayers, George Obel, says implementation of the new electronic tax invoice management system will help the taxman approximate VAT that businesses are supposed to remit from the sale of their products.
The tax to gross domestic product ratio in Kenya stands at 15.3%. This is below the African average of 16%, mainly caused by collection inefficiencies stemming from poor VAT collection and manual system gaps. The Kenya Revenue Authority says due to receiptless backdoor trade, the tax collector has reported a gap of 32% from value-added tax losses.
With this system, we should then be able to narrow the field significantly for this kind of players. Because if you've got to sell, we have got to see that you've got the stocks that you are selling. And the stock you must have either purchased, and you know whom you have purchased from, or you have imported and you've got the data that you have imported, or you've bought from a manufacturer and you have got information from the manufacturer who has sold it to you.
We are trying to avail as much information as possible so that any taxpayer who wants to install the software, they don't have to come to KRA.
He says already over 60% of taxpayers have complied with the previous tax invoice management system, and the remaining 45,000 will be required to comply through the eTIM software, making the ETR machine previously used unnecessary.
There is opportunity that can be we can arbitrage or take full advantage of just looking at the performance of VAT and how we can be able to improve on it.
KRA notes the digital transition will streamline tax collection, opening up more revenue streams for the country without burdening the taxpayer with tax increases.
A lot of time they are refined for a long period of time during audit, verification. This system is going to sort it out because you can now electronically see them and see what they are doing and what they have incurred, and you can be able to give taxpayers their money back. That will be able to help them on their cash flow.
Upon your registration, then we must analyze and see that you have selected the option that is fit for you.
Moving digital has increased revenue collection by at least 24%.
There is opportunity that can be, we can arbitrage or take full advantage of just looking at the performance of VAT and how we can be able to improve on it.
On fictitious invoices, KRA notes the supply chain module function in the new system would allow for approximation based on stock, allowing for accuracy when gauging the compliance rates of businesses as per their business capability.
In what the Kenya Revenue Authority terms as a win-win situation, the new eTIMS will have a supply chain module, which will have businesses operating in the full glare of the tax collector. Hibak Said, for Prime Edition.
Kenya and Japan have committed to strengthen bilateral relations by increasing agricultural exports and attracting more Japanese tourists. This emerged during a meeting between Deputy President Rigathi Gachagua and Japanese Ambassador to Kenya, Okaniwa Ken, at Harambee House Annex.
Kenya exports 7.8 billion shillings worth of products to Japan annually, while importing goods worth 127 billion shillings from the Asian nation. Kenya is seeking to narrow the balance of trade with Japan through increased agricultural exports and tourism arrivals from the Asian nation.
More Japanese tourists to come to Kenya and enjoy our hospitality, enjoy our cultural heritage, come come and, you know, see our wildlife and also interact with the people of Kenya.
With the ravaging drought, which is expected to extend to the fifth consecutive year, the deputy president urged the Japanese government to invest more in climate change mitigation strategies in Kenya.
I really want to say I am very delighted that you are here. I want to assure you of our government's commitment to strengthen our relations and between the two countries and the respective people of Japan and Kenya.
Japan is scouting for new investment opportunities in Kenya that will help increase the number of Japanese companies in Kenya from the current 100 firms that the ambassador says is too low.
Kenya is the largest recipient of our bilateral assistance to the whole of Sub-Saharan Africa.
Yes.
And this is a reflection of how much we attach importance to Kenya. Kenya is a very important country because it is an anchor of the region for stability, and also it is the most important economy in the East Africa region.
Benson Druba reporting for Prime Edition.
Local universities are set to benefit from a new technology training hub by Microsoft. The new workshops are specifically created for university professors who teach technology-focused courses, provides a chance to collaborate with other educators to learn the best modern-day teaching practices. The first cohort of 23 educators drawn from both private and public universities has started the training, which will run for 3 months.
The program will collaborate with engineers from the Microsoft Africa Development Center and will help upskill and reskill participants through a curriculum taught by Microsoft Leap instructors. Along with technical programming and hybrid classroom teaching, educators will also receive training on Microsoft tools that are commonly used in classrooms worldwide. Microsoft IDC Managing Director Catherine Muraga says the course will also expose tutors to advanced topics and allow them to learn and experiment with effective teaching techniques while obtaining essential aspects of carrying out research studies.
Another objective that we have is to partner with the world of academia and also other like-minded industry folk. How do we collectively continue to drive, shorten the digital divide that we have as a country and also as a continent?
The first cohort of 23 educators is drawn from both private and public universities, including Jomo Kenyatta University of Agriculture and Technology, JKUAT, Multimedia University, and Kirinyaga University.
The objective of this program is try and see how can we help staff member or faculty members be equipped with what is happening in the industry, the skills, what the industry is doing, so that then they can be able to pass that to their students.
Frederick Mwoki for Prime Edition.
Absa Bank Kenya has secured 1.26 billion shillings from Eco Business Fund for onward lending to domestic and export businesses participating in the country's agricultural value chain. The funding targets to improve resource efficiency, increase food security, and mitigate the effects of climate change in the agriculture sector.
As part of the collaboration, the two organizations will work to improve the availability and quality of funding dedicated to agricultural value chains, as well as to promote sustainable practices across the sector. Eco Business Fund officials say that supporting sustainable and climate resilient agricultural practices will promote growth of value chains in Kenya.
The sector is confronted with macroeconomic and climate related challenges, resulting in stagnant yields and contributing to food insecurity. Furthermore, lack of market access opportunities, increased post-harvest losses, and unstructured value chains add to the burden on value chain actors. The funding is expected to promote sustainable and climate-smart agricultural practices to mitigate the impact of climate change and contribute to domestic food security.
Under the deal, Eco Business Fund will host relationship building and information sharing roundtable discussions with exporters, aggregators, and processors on prioritizing sustainability in two emerging export crops, namely avocados and macadamias.
We want to promote sustainable production practices, but also strengthen the agri-value chains. We want to dedicate the financing to these businesses by providing, through Absa Bank, patient capital and tailored capital, but also we want to support these businesses through technical assistance and capacity building measures.
In the first program being rolled out, more than 300 players in the cereal, horticulture and dairy value chains will be trained on post-harvest loss reduction and financial literacy.
Thank you, Nuta Mukami, for that story. That's where we put a cap on business news tonight. On the other end of the studio, we have Daniel Wahome with a sports update.
Milioni mbili kila siku kwenye M-Pesa. Chagua lipa na M-Pesa. Paybill number 757070. Account number andika neno loto. Kisha weka star na nambari yako ya simu. Weka kiwango chochote cha pesa kuanzia shilingi 50 hadi 2000.
Au lali.
Lipa kisha subiri draw.
We lala. Nenda kutimizia ndoto zako. Milioni mbili usiamini.
Ujumbe huu umeidhinishwa na BCLB.
A very good evening to you. My name is Daniel Wahome and welcome to Prime Edition Sport. The Cabinet Secretary for Youth Affairs, the Arts and Sports, Ababu Namwamba, says his ministry will work closely with the Bomet County Government to ensure that the Bomet Stadium gets a facelift to meet international standards. The Cabinet Secretary said the facelift is in line with the ministry's master plan on stadia development.
Speaking after inspecting the Bomet Stadium, Sports CS Ababu Namwamba noted that a section of Bomet County Stadium will be demolished and reconstructed afresh to meet international standards.
We have announced that all future sporting facilities, all future stadia, will only be developed in the context of a master plan, a coherent master plan, a master plan that tells the people of Kenya where are we doing what.
Namwamba said stadium, which stalled after being put up by the Bomet County government in 2014, will receive a facelift and will now be reconstructed under a new master plan, which was produced by the government.
If you are going to come to this site to complete the Bomet County Stadium, then you will see a plan in advance, a coherent plan in advance that tells you exactly what we want to do here, how we want to do it, at what cost and for what purpose.
The CS was accompanied by Bomet Governor Professor Hilary Barchok, Director General of Sports Kenya Pius Meto, Bomet County Commissioner Dr. Hamed Omar, among other leaders from the region.
From preliminary information that we are getting and from previous advice that we have received from relevant institutions, a section of this stadium has to be demolished and worked afresh.
For Prime Edition Sports, I'm Daniel Mwendwa.
Now, a team of 31 athletes will depart the country tomorrow for Dar es Salaam for this year's East Africa Under 20 and Under 18 Athletics Championships. The championships will be held in Dar es Salaam on the 10th and 11th of this month.
Isaac Omurua and talented Selfa Jambo are among the athletes that will represent the country in the East Africa Athletics Under 20 and Under 18 Athletic Championships.
Yeah, my best time so far 10.7, and I'm targeting Kloid to a 10.5. I'm a 10.4. And Takimbia ni like ni kwa international athlete. I participate in the Olympics.
Yeah. Nataka ni kuwe kama yego. Nikiendelea kuimprove ndio ni motivate wasichana wengine pia kwa kila kitu inawezekana. Medali yangu ambayo mimi mwenyewe natarajia ni gold.
The team is made up of 15 athletes, 7 men and 8 girls for the under 20 event, and a squad of 16, 8 boys and 8 girls for the under 18 event. Wesley Kibet will take part in the 800 meters, where the long distance team will comprise 3,000 meter world under 20 bronze medalist Nancy Cherop, among others.
Malengo yangu kule ni kufanya msuri tu. Colombia ni tulikuwa nakimbia watu wenye wanatoka mbali mbali na nikaleta bronze. Sasa maombi yangu ni nikifika Dar es Salaam nifanye msuri nilete gold.
The regional youth and junior championships will be held in Dar es Salaam on 10th and 11th of this month. Kingori Mwangi for Channel 1 Sports.
Thank you, Kingori Mwangi, for that report. Now, children from Bangladesh slums in Mombasa County are among hundreds of children in Kenya who have benefited from the Gift of Chess organization, with their talent being identified and directed to productive competitions. The founder of Chess in Slums Africa, Tunde Onakoya, toured Mombasa County for the first time after Nairobi and visited the children in Bangladesh area as he continued to oversee the development programs in several slums in Kenya.
Excitement filled the air as the children interacted with the chess boards, carefully playing the game. The founder of Chess in Slums Africa, Tunde Anakoya, said the game will go a long way in improving their skills and knowledge.
Because I believe chess can be a very powerful tool, right? A powerful educational resource to develop young minds, right? As Africa begins to grow, as we begin to really work towards like prosperity as a continent, it is important, you know, to be able to invest in these children, because they are the ones that will go on to solve Africa's biggest problems, right, and change the status quo. So
he noted that the children who will perform best will be awarded and have a chance to travel the world to showcase their prowess in the game.
It's been amazing to see them sit calmly and, you know, make moves, right, and play so excellently. And I mean, along the line, they would also get to know that there's a reward for hard work, because the ones that perform really well, they get rewarded. And it also exposes them to people and places, right? A lot of them will get to leave the slums to compete, even travel the world to compete, right, in chess tournaments.
The Gift of Chess organization's global outreach director, Phyllis Ngigi, noted that they are making inroads and will soon be stationed across the country.
We are in Nakuru, Mombasa. We've reached here in the Bangladesh, also in Kwale and Kilifi. Then we have Nairobi, Kiabu, Eldoret, and we are moving deeper, because the first batch of 1,000 boats arrived in July last year. So we've been distributing since last year, August, and more boats are coming, so that we are able to reach out more counties in the country.
Bani Somboy is a chess ambassador, and she encouraged other children to join the game at a tender age, terming it exciting and educative.
It was during the Hamove Next classes, which is an online place where girls from all over the world meet. We played a league, so in those leagues they saw my talent and they asked me if I wanted to be an ambassador.
From Mombasa County, I am Anburu.
Great to see children picking up the sport played by the greatest strategy makers in the world. Now, the UEFA Champions League round of 16 resumes tonight as Chelsea host Borussia Dortmund, while Benfica will be up against Belgium's Club Brugge. Meanwhile, Reece James and Christian Pulisic could return as the Blues look to overturn a one-goal deficit suffered in the first leg in Germany.
The aim is breaking.
Chelsea will go into the contest having been knocked out of two domestic.
João Félix now. That's nicely done. Mudryk now. Might have hit the defender's hand. Mudryk. Reece James.
Germany forward Ademeye, who scored the winner 3 weeks ago, has not played since 19th February after picking up a muscle injury.
Cutting inside, Modest, Loftus-Cheek with the ball, and here's Koulibaly! Straight at Koebelen off the line.
Dortmund, second on goal difference behind Bayern Munich in the Bundesliga, traveled to London looking to record their 11th consecutive victory in all competitions, while Chelsea are hoping to secure back-to-back wins for the first time since October. Advance, Graham Potter's side will have to score 2 goals in a match for the first time since 27th December. In another match, Benfica will host Club Brugge.
Well, I was hoping that you'd been the one to sign up, but nevertheless, the mic is with me. Listen, tomorrow is International Women's Day.
Yes.
And I don't know, celebrating your mom is a given. So I want to pose this question to the both of you. Mm-hmm. Which woman stands out? Let me start with Wauma, because Wailimo's Day.
All right. It's tomorrow, yes. Yeah.
All right, Tom, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to celebrate one woman, but a collective. Mm-hmm. The most underrated teachers in the Republic of Kenya.
Which
one? Early childhood and development education teachers, kindergarten teachers.
Ah.
How they are able to maintain order in a class of 20 children who've got their own minds and make them sing the alphabet and do the number count and eventually just get them the basic literacy.
Yeah.
Those are the most underrated teachers, but yeah. I think they're the most important teachers in the entire education system.
Yeah.
Celebrate those ones.
That's a good one. And by the way, we are told that children's, the brain develops, I don't know, between the first 9 years of
actually, if you don't develop their character by the age of 10, you don't have a child anymore.
Mm.
Yeah.
Tom, I'll not even wait for you to ask me, because I am celebrating one woman who was spotted over the weekend, a Kisumu lady by the name Shireen Pami, whose video went viral for performing with her daughter on stage.
What?
I celebrate you, Shireen Pami.
Ah, where is that? Just say that again, in Kisumu City.
In Kisumu City.
Kisumu Dala.
Yes.
Yeah. Ah, okay. Tom, we're off tomorrow.
Who is breaking the barriers and ensuring that she does what she needs
by
to do.
By the way, Tom, we're off tomorrow. The idea of having, you know, it's Women's Day, so the idea of having an all-women's bulletin sits pretty well with me.
Even with me.
Actually, it's going to be on all women's bulletin, and we're going to be celebrating women from the gate all the way to the anchor. Everyone will be celebrated tomorrow, and also we'll be bringing you that story and much more.
So we expect an entire woman.
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
It's going to be we're going to be wearing an African print.
What?
Yes. So it's going to be
beautiful.
Beautiful.
Sorry, did we just discuss strategy on air? But anyway, that's good. I think that's good. So we are not on air tomorrow. So on behalf of the entire team, I want to thank you so much for joining us this Tuesday. And we have our sign language interpreter, Susan Thuku. Mm-hmm. That's right. Susan Thuku. Asante sana. There she is smiling. Susan, smiling. Good. Well, we gotta go. Thank you for watching. We will see you tomorrow on the International Women's Day. My name is Tom Mboya.
My name is Wairimu Jenga.
My name is Daniel Wahome.
Good night. From Nairobi, Kenya. Bye-bye and see you.